And welcome everybody to ECPW's 20th anniversary show here on Seaside Communications, powered by Rogers. Boy, we've got a great opener here. The upperclassman Jefferson James was the freshman when he debuted in ECPW, and some would argue that his status has gone to his head since then. Once very popular with the ECPW faithful, not so much anymore. Making a return to ECPW after a lengthy absence was not in the good books of the fans in this very building. Has given a bit of a rough go, but he's talking a big game. Is Jefferson James, the upperclassman, decked out in his very regal looking royal blue and gold, but he'll be put to the test tonight in front of this big crowd in New Waterford, celebrating 20 years of East Coast Pro Wrestling. Jefferson James is a part of that tradition. As I said, he'll have his work cut out for him in tonight's opening contest. And I know there are people from all over Nova Scotia who've made the trip, but I don't know if Jefferson James is very popular in any part of the province. Scotty McPherson, the referee for tonight's contest. Scotty always does a great job. We should mention that in other occasions, Scotty has split the duties with Emily Parker, but Emily Parker on assignment officiating Impact Rebellion. So congratulations to Emily. Well deserved. Of course, great lineage there. The daughter of former Maritime referee Frank Parker.
From the crossroads, Jonathan Cross.
Jonathan Cross, newcomer relatively to the wrestling business, as he was somebody who wrestled at Celtic Chaos 2021. It was just beginning his wrestling career and has already come a long way. Looking for his first victory here in ECPW. And certainly will have the favor of the crowd. You can see him being well greeted by the fans here in New Waterford. Should be an outstanding opening contest here tonight. Certainly a good test for Jonathan Cross. As I said, he's wrestling a more experienced opponent. But he may very well be up for the task. And again, a tremendous opening bout here. Great crowd in New Waterford for ECPW's 20th anniversary show. Scotty McPherson, your referee. Jefferson James in blue is Jonathan Cross in black. Should be a tremendous opening contest here. So many great memories over the years. ECPW and that legacy just gets added to tonight for this opening contest. Certainly Jonathan Cross does not have to work hard to get the favor. Look at that, Jefferson James trying to take a cheap shot. Good job by Scotty McPherson, the referee, not allowing it to happen. The best in the business here in ECPW, both in the ring and in the stripes. Jonathan Cross basking in the adulation, so to speak, of this crowd here in New Waterford. Some of the audience giving Jefferson James a rough time due to his sparkly attire, we'll call it, but as I said, a very regal look to it, but that's not currying any favor with the fans here in New Waterford. As the bell is rung and we're getting ready to get underway with this opening matchup. Jefferson James really has brought this on himself, this hostile reception. As I said, he used to be much more popular with the fans, well, when he conducted himself in a more reasonable manner, but that's not been the Jefferson James we have seen the last number of shows, but still a very capable in-ring competitor, no doubt about that. If you're Jonathan Cross, maybe you can use this crowd to get some momentum going and give yourself an advantage in this opening contest. Jefferson James, no stranger to encounters with these fans here in New Waterford, and maybe a little bit of mind games here against Jonathan Cross, because when he's against the ropes, he's protected. Cross can't begin his attack. As Cross trying to start this match with a standard lockup, but Jefferson James not showing any interest in physically competing here in the early going. And finally, we get this underway. Strong tie up by both men as Cross backs James into a corner to working along the ropes here. Bit of a feeling out process here in the early going as Jonathan Cross. And the headlock takeover brings James to the mat. Fans approve of that here in New Waterford. Pretty effective way to wear down your opponent in the early going of a matchup. Kind of assert physical dominance here. As I said, Jonathan Cross finding his way between the ropes. And certainly a victory here would vault him up the contender standings and get his ECPW career off to a nice start. Wearing down Jefferson James in front of this big crowd here in New Waterford. Good exhibition of strength there by Cross. James was trying to use the ropes for momentum, but Cross was having none of it. He was able to maintain control of this headlock, working a strong hold to wear down his opponent. This time, James successfully backed Cross into the ropes, and you know, given the tactics of Jefferson James, there was a cheap shot as he was given the five count, and rather than just break in a sportsmanlike fashion, he decides to, after breaking, throw the punch, and Cross almost, I don't want to say amused, but seems to shake off that assault from Jefferson James. And again, James has not been in a hurry to engage. Perhaps wants to slow things down, maybe take the crowd out of this contest. Tie up in the center of the squared circle here. ECPW 20th anniversary show here in New Waterford. Whipped into the ropes and a shoulder tackle. And very well scouted by Cross. He seems to have a good read on his opponent. No doubt he was watching some tape. He knows what to expect from Jefferson James. Hip toss blocked. Another hip toss block. Boy, talk about good scouting from both wrestlers. No counter for a knee to the stomach, though, and a powerful suplex by Cross. First pinfall attempt of the match and a two count. And boy, even just making your opponent kick out at two, having to exert that extra energy. Jonathan Cross will be happy with how he's begun this match. Reversal on a duck. Whip into the ropes. And a counter clothesline. Good counter wrestling from both competitors here. And first pinfall attempt of the match for James. Not sure he got a two count on there, but regardless, wasn't enough for the three. James was questioning the official, but we know that that was not a three count. James continuing to banter with the crowd, and I really don't know why he thinks he benefits from that. He certainly has developed a bit of an attitude here the last few years in ECPW. Powerful forearm by Jefferson James. He backs Cross into the corner. Oh boy, you can feel the impact of that chop all the way here at ringside. You can hear it and see it. The Cross will have a big red mark on the chest coming home tonight. Using form, almost trying to cut off the breathing of Cross by getting an arm up in the mouth. I know a kick to the stomach as well, working on that midsection. And certainly Jefferson James has swung the pendulum, so to speak, to his advantage. Now trying to use that turnbuckle against Cross. And Cross, with a reversal of fortunes, throws James into the buckle. And now he's going to introduce him to the opposite corner. Maybe he's going to go for all four. That's three. And look at that, he's giving every corner of the arena what they want to see. And that's Jefferson James's face hitting the leather of the turnbuckle. Crowd very much in approval of what they're seeing now. Jonathan Cross pinfall attempt, and it's another two count. But certainly Cross doing a good job of establishing dominance in this contest the last couple of minutes. But taken down to the mat by James. They'll whip him into the opposite corner with some significant impact. Going to go for a suplex here, it looks like. Is he going to be able to get Cross up? Yes, he will. Nice vertical suplex there by Jefferson James and letting the fans know, hey, that was a piece of cake, but it's not enough for a three count. Certainly pushing the limits for Jonathan Cross, and Jefferson James questioning Scotty McPherson, but the crowd very much in agreement with the official here. James whips Cross across. Duck a clothesline, duck another clothesline. Again, well scouted, but he gets him in a sleeper hold. Jonathan Cross is a big trouble here. Scotty McPherson's going to have to check the arm here momentarily. He brings him down. Looks like he's going to adjust into a headlock. Trying to wear down his opponent. You can hear the fans clapping here in the Waterford. Great crowd on hand. And they're going to try to push Jonathan Cross to see if he can get into this maneuver and try to get back into this matchup. Stomping the mat, trying to, as I said, curry the crowd favor. Three elbows to break the hold. And not sure if Cross knew where he was. And Insiguri is blocked. Powerful elbow drop there by James. And goes down for a pin attempt. And I don't know if that was fatigue or arrogance, but a bit of a cocky cover there. Didn't hook the leg. And I mentioned Jonathan Cross, a relatively new competitor, but a competitor of that caliber, you've got to hook the leg. Well, I don't know if that was him testing his opponent to see what he's got or not. But regardless, it was not enough to get the three count. Gained steam. Used his momentum against him. Now Cross throwing his opponent's head into the turnbuckle once more. And a powerful uppercut with the elbow. Looked like he might try to go for a power slam there, but it was blocked. Jefferson James using his elbow to wear down the upper back there of Cross and prevent himself from being slammed to the mat. Big knee to the forehead of Cross. Pinfall attempt, hooks the leg this time. Did come a little bit closer to getting the three count, but Cross was able to get up. If you're Jefferson James, maybe you feel like you're getting closer. Certainly has carried the offense, so to speak, in the last few minutes of this matchup. Brings Cross to his feet, but it's blocked. Takeover slam. What a great counter by Jonathan Cross. Great exhibition of power. And now both men are starting to feel the battle wounds of this contest. Who will get to their feet next? You hear the crowd chanting Cross. You know who their favorite is. Scotty McPherson will administer the 10 count. We'll see if the competitors can get to their feet. Hopefully get a nice resolution to this matchup. Great opener here. The 20th anniversary show of East Coast Pro Wrestling. This big crowd here in New Waterford. Double open hand slaps to the face. They have Jefferson James reeling. Tries the counter. Speaking of counters, takeover by James. Kick to the stomach and he's going to go into the corner. Says upper class, out of a shake, rattle, and roll there. He's got a cover attempt, one, a two. Oh, and just in the nick of time, Cross kicking out. And it was criticizing Jefferson James earlier for his covers, but boy, he went the full measure that time. He even used his leg, and given that, throwing a high impact maneuver, he's questioning what he's got to do to beat Jonathan Cross. I think if you're Jefferson James, you just have to go right back to the attack. You can't give your opponent any time to recover. Then he's thrown into the turnbuckle. Chess felt the full brunt of that. Taken down on the mat. Shades of Sister Abigail. As Jonathan Cross taking Jefferson James for a ride. Reverse DDT, is that going to be enough for the victory? It is!
Here's your winner, Jonathan Cross!
And what a victory for young Jonathan Cross, the first at ECPW, but I don't think it's going to be the last. We haven't seen the last of this young man. And to chalk a notch in his belt. Get a win over an opponent the caliber of Jefferson James. Congratulations to Jonathan Cross. He picks up a big victory tonight over Jefferson James. And hearing it from the fans cheering into Waterford. Justin Newhook, the Newfoundland Nightmare Wrestling veteran of Atlantic Canada since 2015, has had success in both the singles ranks and tag teams, been a tag team champion around the Maritimes. lost his last couple of bouts at ECPW, so he's trying to shake that, but certainly this is a very talented competitor. As I said, he's had success individually and in the tag team ranks around the Maritimes. Maybe not the most popular wrestler here in New Waterford. Getting the thumbs down from some of the faithful here. You know you're going to see a heck of a match, though, if Justin Newhook is here. This is the 20th anniversary show for East Coast Pro Wrestling. What a 20 years it's been. And, we've seen a lot of great competitors like Justin Newhook over the years. Yes. One half of the Sabotage tag team. As I said, a very capable solo competitor as well. He'll have a test for himself this evening, though, at the New Waterford District Community Center. Battle of the Islands here, so to speak. Both Newfoundland and PEI represented. Bradford Montague wrestled at Autumn Aggression 2020. So he has wrestled in ECPW before. And another guy who's had success in a lot of different places. He's actually held a tag team championship in Junction City Wrestling in Toronto. Still currently holds that championship for over a year. And he's coming out to a nice response here from the fans. And a bit of a curiosity for those who were not at that Autumn Aggression show, but certainly a very physically impressive man. And as I said, this should be a tremendous matchup here. As this is ECPW's 20th anniversary show. Great job by Sheldon McLean putting together this talented group of wrestlers for tonight's action. A lot of great matchups. We're about to see another one here. Bradford Montague and Justin Newhook. I'd say Bradford probably a slight size advantage, but these are two big guys, so a bit of a hoss fight here, perhaps. I look forward to seeing it. And Newhook trying to jumpstart the match, Montague having none of it, and a powerful slap right into the chest of Justin Newhook. Another powerful slap as Bradford Montague said it may be a slight size advantage. He's trying to overpower Newhook here, and nothing, I guess, the knee to the stomach won't fix. Duck of a clothesline, and a kick to the gut. Attempt of a suplex here. What a display of power to bring Newhook down to the mat. Is he going to go for another one? With a standing suplex. Check out the hang time on that. He was up in the air for a good 5 seconds. Pinfall attempt, one and a two, and Newhook kicks out, but he's reeling in the early stages of this matchup. It's Bradford Montague, popular competitor here in New Waterford. Clothesline into the corner, and Justin Newhook has no defense for that. Airplane spin. And Justin Newhook's going to be feeling pretty dizzy after that, but I think he may have got the eyes. Scotty McPherson was not in position to see it, so Newhook taking some shortcuts and a sidewalk slam. Pinfall attempt. Newhook's first of the match. Montague gets up, though. You talk about high-impact wrestling here in the early stages of this contest. And Justin Newhook maybe trying to slow this match down, but he's going to go for an armbar of some sort here, try to weaken the opponent. This is a good strategy if you're Justin Newhook, because you saw in the early parts of this contest, Montague trying to use a lot of high-impact maneuvers. You try to take away his arm, he's not going to have the strength to do those slams and suplexes that we saw earlier. Pinfall attempt, and it's a two-count. But certainly Justin Newhook is not above bending the rules. I said earlier, he looked like he may have got a poke to the eye, and did so in a way that it was obscured from the referee's line of vision. As I said, Scotty McPherson, one of the best, but you can't see everything in there. And now Newhook has his opponent backed into a corner. A couple of kicks into the stomach. And he's done a good job of grounding the big man here. A powerful suplex. Boy, you can hear the impact of that all the way over here. Infall attempt and two count. I talked about it earlier, though. Even making your opponent kick out, you're really wearing him down. Especially, as I said, in a match like this where he's seen so many high-impact maneuvers in the early going. Might end up being a test for both guys. As punches to the stomach there of Newark. He's able to shake it off and reestablish control. Whips him into the ropes. Duck of a clothesline. Oh, a backbreaker. Did a good job driving the knee into the back. Pinfall attempt and a two count. As I was wondering if Money was going to reach for the ropes there just because of the positioning of the pin, but he was able to get the kick out before the count of three. But if you're Justin Newark, you're wondering if you're getting a little bit closer here. I mean, taking the crowd out of this matchup, so to speak, and talked about him earlier, going to work on the arm. Now he's going to work on the leg, so just fundamentals. Take away the key appendages, so to speak. Half crab here. Try to go to work on the leg and the back. Certainly a move like this puts a lot of pressure on the back of Montague. Crowd here to Waterford. Great crowd. Trying to get Bradford Montague back into this matchup as he's feeling all the impact here of this grab. And Montague's actually reached the ropes, and now he's being administered the five count. And Justin Newhook taking advantage of the grace period there. But certainly the impact, you can feel it. You can see that Bradford Montague is holding his back, as that was the intent of that maneuver. Backed into a corner now as Newhook will throw some powerful blows into the stomach. And now some kicks. An assault of all kinds on the midsection of Bradford Montague. Finds himself in a bad way here. Now a kick to the throat. That's essentially a chokehold. That's why you see Scotty McPherson administering the count there. Now look at this. Just giving some cheap shots to the back here. And now the referee catches on. As I said, Justin Newhook, a very capable in-ring competitor, but not somebody who is above bending the rules. Pinfall attempt, one and a two. And you'll see, smart move to pull him away from the ropes, but not hooking the legs. A bit of an arrogant cover there by Newhook. Is he going to go back to that crab again? This is good strategy here from Justin Newhook again. He's somebody who's been in the ring since 2015. He's wrestled all over Canada. So certainly somebody who knows his way around the ring and having his way with Bradford Montague here in this matchup thus far, much to the dismay of the fans here in New Waterford. Great crowd here at the New Waterford and District Community Center. And now you can hear the crowd rallying behind Bradford Montague. He tries to make his way to the ropes. Had success in breaking the hold like that last time. And he does get to the ropes again. And if you're Justin Newhook, you have to wonder what you can do, because he did a pretty good job of centering that hole, which is what you want to do if you're going to use the submission maneuver. You want to do it in the middle of the ring to make the distance to the ropes as far apart as possible. Really make the guy work for it to try to break the hold. Oh, a choke slam brings Montague down. Powerful leg drop. Montague uses his instincts to get out of the way. And now both men are down. Montague still feeling the impact from the previous assaults, and certainly missing that leg drop is going to take its own toll on Newhook. And now it's a battle of who's going to get to their feet first. 10 count being administered here. Crowd urging Bradford Montague to get to his feet first. Can both, one or both, beat the 10 count? Counts waved off. Both to their feet. Powerful clothesline by Montague. And another clothesline. Montague had the airplane spin earlier. He's going to do it again. Let's go spinning. But Justin Newhook wakes up with a headache tomorrow. You'll know why. Not all the Tylenol in the world's going to fix that. Fans starting to count the rotations. I wonder if Montague himself is going to get dizzy here. I think he is. This is a very, very impressive airplane spin. That's no small man he's lifting up there. And Scotty McPherson having to get into the line of danger. Puts it down, and Newhook has no bearings about him whatsoever. Could be a sitting duck for Bradford Montague. Thrown to the mat, pinfall attempt. One and a two. Oh, and just in the nick of time. Radford Montague, almost a pinfall victory, and I really like the strategy there, trying to disorient your opponent with that airplane spin and throw him to the mat with a powerful blow. And he's probably wondering what else he has to do to finish this match up. And his possible high-risk maneuver here, going up to the top rope. It will be the middle rope either way, a big risk regardless. Keeping his opponent in his line of sight, and just instinct there by Justin Newark. Get to the ropes, and that's going to be enough to ground his opponent. Talk about high impact. Falling for the top rope, that's never a pleasant experience. Newark brings his opponent to a standing position. Reversal into the ropes. Duck, and is he going to go back to that airplane spin? Elbows. Trying to bring his opponent down. Into a power bomb. Is that going to be enough? And it is. Power bomb coming off the ropes for Justin Newark. And he is the winner of this contest. A hard fought bout for both men. But it is Justin Newark that is the winner with that power bomb. Finishing off Radford Montague. He is the winner here in our second contest in ECPW's 20th anniversary show here in New Waterford at District Community Center on Seaside Communications, powered by Rogers. Some big time history tonight, folks, in New Waterford. It was announced earlier this evening by the commissioner, John Patterson, that ECPW, for the first time, is crowning a women's champion. What a heck, look at that beautiful belt. And the competitors, well, no shortage of star-studded competitors in this match. Divya Fiji making her way to the ring. It's her ECPW debut, but this is a very, very well-accomplished woman. Has competed in the United Kingdom, the USA, and Japan. Once wrestled Tamina on SmackDown. More than 8 years experience in the squared circle. Currently a champion in both Northland Wrestling and Battle Arts Pro in Ontario, or has been a champion in both of those companies, I should say. So this is a very capable competitor looking to add another title to her mantle. And making her return to ECPW, Bea Moss. Last time she was in ECPW, she was victorious in a four-way match in 2019 against Chantel, Casey Spinelli, and Madison Miles. Undefeated in her two appearances in ECPW. Curly holds championships in multiple promotions in Ontario. Began wrestling in 2012, and I think both of these women are pretty popular with the fans. And I think the fact that there's a women's championship is pretty popular here, and I think it's great. There's been so many talented women that have wrestled in ECPW, and it's great to see them have a championship to vie for. Boy, as I said before, a couple of stars battling for this inaugural championship. Whichever woman comes out on top, it's going to be well earned. Certainly both Moss and Fiji bring a lot of energy in front of this crowd, who's pretty excited to see two stars in the wrestling industry. As I said, both women have wrestled well beyond the borders of Atlantic Canada. Look forward to seeing who emerges victorious here in tonight's contest. Bea Moss, the more familiar of the two competitors, the ECPW, but as I said, I think Fiji will not waste any time making a positive impression. Both women wrestling along the ropes here. Neither one really able to establish an advantage in the early going. Again, this is the first ever ECPW Women's Championship match. Saw the title belt prior to this contest. And whichever woman garners the victory, well, will be the first champion. And there's only one first. Certainly something always special. You're wrestling in a match like this. Both women trying to work the arm here. Moss briefly in control, but almost a full Nelson there by Fiji. Let's turn to a type of headlock. And again, this looks like these are two women that have wrestled each other, although not in ECPW, and you can tell there is some familiarity. As Divya Fiji working the arm of Bia Moss in the early going. As I said, two women that have well scouted the opponent. Bia Moss, some big time athleticism. Spinning kick and a headlock takeover. And she is earning the accolades of the crowd. Why not bring a high energy style? Powerful knees, early pinfall attempt. This could be over quick. And a two count. And Divya Fiji perhaps taken aback by this aerial assault of Bia Moss. Another powerful kick using those long legs, kicking into the midsection. Another powerful kick to the head. And Bia Moss all kinds of fired up. She wants to be that first ever ECPW Women's Champion. Taking over the ropes. Counter and a forearm by Fiji, and she uses the momentum of the ropes against Bia Moss. And takes her down to the mat. Suplex attempt, snap suplex. Divya Fiji swings the momentum her way in the early going in this matchup. A fast-paced start for these two women. As broken up by the referee, Scotty McPherson. As Moss backed into a corner, and now it's Divya Fiji using leg strength to put in an impact on Bia Moss against the turnbuckle. Now she's backed into a corner. Powerful forearm right into the stomach of Bia Moss, now into the head. That's Fiji brings her down with a neck breaker of sorts. Impact move here, pinfall attempt, and it's a two count. And Fiji questioning the official, saying, "Was you sure that wasn't a three? Was it two?" Bia Moss getting her shoulder up. As Fiji overhead forearm to the back of Bia Moss. So both of these women coming into this match shot out of a cannon, as you'd expect, fighting for the first ever ECPW Women's Champion. As I said, whoever wins, they can't take that away from them. They'll be the first. Chop by Divya Fiji. Brings Bia Moss to the other corner, second corner. And a lick and a chop is avoided this time. And a heavy chop by Bia Moss. No licking here, just powerful chops to the upper body. And now Fiji trying to fault off further assault and counters with a punch to the face. Now Fiji using the strength of her leg, and she's got to watch herself. She wouldn't want to get disqualified, and gives Scotty McPherson the eye there. She's turning up the intensity here. Realize she's going to have to pull out all the stops to win this match. Fisherman suplex, bridge for a pinfall attempt, and a two count. Nice. Divya Fiji, again, has wrestled many countries. First time here in ECPW, but has wrestled all around the world. And would love to have a reason to come back to ECPW as women's champion, as would Bia Moss. Wearing down both the back and the upper body here. Putting all the pressure on Bia and bringing her down to the mat. Divya Fiji is, looks like a submission move of some sort here. Not sure what she's going to attempt. But whatever it is, it looks pretty painful. Twisting the legs of Bia Moss, and now bending back and into an STF. Working every body part of Bia Moss here. And she's a bit of a distance from the ropes. So Moss is gonna have her work cut out for her, trying to force a break. And that's to say nothing. And the hold is broken, but that's gonna do some damage, and Bia may be grounded for the time being. And certainly that was the intent. As Fiji, another forearm, and Moss counters with some instinct. Moss and Fiji trading forearms here. Kick ducked, another kick ducked. Again, well scouted by both women. And that time, neither was able to escape the impact. Both go down to the mat. A couple of powerful kicks. And the 10 count being administered here. Again, this is a historic match. A great tradition of women's wrestling in ECPW, but this is the first time there's been a championship at stake. Listen to the crowd applauding both these women. I don't think anybody wants to see a countdown finish. They want to see a good pinfall or submission to end this contest. Clothesline by Bia Moss. House of fire there, big elbow. Coming with some big forearms here, has Divya Fiji on the ropes. Reversal. Another kick to the head. Again, using those long legs. Pinfall attempt here for Biamas. One and a two. Oh, and in the nick of time, Fiji gets her hand on the ropes. Great ring awareness there to break that cover up. But again, if you're Biamas, you wonder if you're getting closer. As Moss in purple, Fiji in the red and black attires. Tried to lift Moss up, wasn't able to do so. Throws her into the ropes. Now, knee to the stomach, couple of knees to the stomach. Trying to set up something here. And uses the force of her knee into the head of Fiji now. Establishing control with some powerful overarm forearms to the back of Divya Fiji. Moss kick to the stomach. But it's now Divya Fiji in control of this matchup. Still trying to get her bearings about her. Now she's trying to fire the crowd up. I think the fans are respecting the efforts of both women here. Taking over to the mat, pinfall attempt. And it's a three count. And look at the face of Divya Fiji. Congratulations, Divya Fiji. She's wrestled on multiple continents and now has championship gold here in Canada. Your first ever ECPW Women's Champion. Divya Fiji, congratulations. What a tremendous matchup. You know it was going to be a barn burner, and it sure was. And Divya Fiji, well earned. Congratulations, Divya, your first ever ECPW Women's Champion. Earns that title here, the 20th anniversary show of East Coast Pro Wrestling at the New Waterford District Community Center, being broadcast on Seaside Communications, powered by Rogers. And what an ovation for Cowboy Mike Hughes returning to ECPW. And you want to talk about a man who's given everything he had to this company. As John Patterson said, the longest reigning champion in ECPW history. He won that title against Duke McIsaac in 2007. It would be ultimately Duke McIsaac that would defeat him in 2019. Of course, he was retired in a career versus title match by Lincoln Steen. But Mike Hughes, somebody who you didn't necessarily always admire his tactics, but really, I think when people reflect on the career and what he's accomplished here, you've got to respect really a pillar and somebody who, as much as anybody, was responsible for building this company and somebody who beat. No shortage of big victories during that ECPW title reign. Mike Hughes giving the people what they want here. Defeated Rhino, Al Snow, Gene Gangrel during his title reign.
Thank you for coming out to the ECPW 20th anniversary show. The last time I was in Cape Breton, I wasn't sure if it would be my last time here in a wrestling ring. And unfortunately, I had a career-ending injury trying to come back. And unfortunately, I had to retire from professional wrestling. But guys, I just want to thank every single one of you guys for supporting me for 24 years in pro wrestling. And it's been my honor and my longest reigning champion in Canadian history, but to do it in front of each and every one of you. Thank you very much, everyone, from the bottom of my heart. It's been my pleasure to wrestle for you guys. Thank you very much.
And wait a minute, this is an unwelcome interruption. Mike Hughes giving a heartfelt thank you to the fans of ECPW. And for some reason, Lincoln Steen feels the need to come in here and interrupt it. Mike Hughes helped build this company, champion for 12 years, and didn't have a chance to say a proper goodbye, and now he's being disrespected like this. He's going to be wrestling Andre Mayette. Are you talking about somebody who has won the approval of the ECPW faithful? He, by his own admission, wanted to start doing things the right way. And since that proclamation, he has not lost at ECPW. He's won his last three matches here. Certainly a great show of respect with Mike Hughes. These are two men very familiar to the ECPW audience. We talk about Mike Hughes, and certainly want to congratulate Mike on an outstanding career. But in the last number of years, Andre Mayette has been a key part of ECPW. Let's bring it to John Patterson for the introductions.
Andre Mayette!
Andre Mayette's been competing since 2008.
I almost forgot. There was a special mystery guest referee for this match.
A bombshell! And Lincoln Steen looks like he has seen a ghost. And he is not impressed with John Patterson. I don't think he's impressed with Mike Hughes or Andre Mayette either. And despite everything we've seen, I know Mike Hughes, he wants to call this match down the middle. This should be a tremendous encounter. Two wrestlers who, despite their history, I don't believe have ever crossed paths in ECPW. Lincoln Steen, a veteran of the squared circle in the Maritimes, over 50 matches in East Coast Pro Wrestling. He's only missed one show. As I said, Andre Mayette, an experienced wrestler himself. As I said, he's had a lot of success in recent years in the ECPW ranks and certainly has the crowd on his side here tonight. Cowboy Mike Hughes training in tights for stripes. Great to see Mike in the ring. Obviously, as he mentioned, retired from in-ring competition, but still capable of enforcing the law, which he'll do in tonight's matchup. Clean break by Andre Mayette and a reasonable count by Mike Hughes. As I said, I know despite ill will towards Lincoln Steen, I don't dispute that Mike Hughes is going to call this down the middle. And Lincoln Steen doesn't really have any reason to protest. It's Hughes was administering a count, as an official is supposed to do. Collar and elbow tap in the center of the squared circle. As Steen powered into the corner. And again, Mike Hughes administering the count. Clean break by Andre Mayette. As I mentioned, he's somebody who's considers himself reformed, and as I said, it's working well for him. He's been tremendously successful the last 2 years in ECPW. And Lincoln Steen claiming there was a hair pull, but Mike Hughes, more famous for a wrestler, but he's doing a great job in this matchup. He was well positioned, and he knew there was no hair pull there. It's typical theatrics from Lincoln Steen trying to rile the crowd up for whatever reason. I'm not sure that's going to give him any sort of advantage in this matchup. As now he throws Mayette. And again, Mike Hughes with a reasonable count. Steen reluctantly breaks. And now Steen putting his hands on an official. And technically, Mike Hughes would have the grounds to disqualify Steen, but he's not going to. He's going to show some leeway here. Steen looks like he's pointing to something on the mat. Maybe this could be some mind games here by Lincoln Steen. Calling out the credentials of Mike Hughes. I don't think Mike Hughes has to explain himself to anybody. Well, he's accomplished in ECPW. Mike Hughes getting a little frustrated, and like everybody else in this arena, he wants to see a good wrestling match, and Lincoln Steen is not particularly looking forward to engaging. As another lockup in the middle of the ring, as Andre Mayette wringing the arm of Lincoln Steen. Brings him down to the mat. Steen back to a standing position. Like Steen almost looking to the crowd for help. He's not going to get any there, but a kick to the foot allows him to wring the arm of Andre Mayette. And Lincoln Steen's request for approval from the crowd goes about as well as you think it would, which is to say, not well at all. You can see the pain on his face now. Is Andre Mayette going to work on the arm of Steen? Great crowd here in New Waterford for this 20th anniversary show of East Coast Pro Wrestling. 20 great years. As I mentioned, Lincoln Steen over 50 matches at ECPW. Lincoln Steen, both a former Celtic roots and heavyweight champion in ECPW. Layette going to work on the arm again. It's battle of one-upmanship between the two competitors battling to wear down the opponent's arms. Good strategy, try to take away a basic appendage. Andre Mayette going to the top rope. Bit of a high-risk maneuver here. Look at him walking the rope. What athleticism for the big guy. Bit of a, talk about a high-risk maneuver, and it does not pay off. And if you're Lincoln Steen, I know the fans here don't like it, but that's good strategy. Is Andre Mayette putting himself into a compromising position? As impressive as it was, tightrope walking as he did, putting yourself in position to be taken down in a heavy way. And now he's going to have to try to beat the 10 count. And Lincoln Steen, he'll take a count-out victory. He's not above that. Mike Hugh is wanting to make sure he has ample opportunity to try to beat this count. This could be a turning point in this matchup. As Mike Hughes wants to see this decided fairly, whether it's in the ring by a pinfall submission or a count out. Now Lincoln Steen going outside the ring. That could break the count, but Mike Hughes doesn't see Lincoln Steen, who's going to try to maybe sneak up from behind here on Andre Mayette. And he does just that, hitting him right in the back. And Mike Hughes starting to lose patience with the tactics of Lincoln Steen, which was a case for him at the end of his wrestling career here in ECPW as well. He just wants to see Mayette have an opportunity to get back in the ring and return to this contest to equal footing. Powerful axe handle out of the back of Andre Mayette. Seeing a knee into the back of Andre Mayette. Steen pulls him to the center of the ring. And a powerful knee drop. That's a signature move from Lincoln Steen. It's going to be enough to win this contest. Two and a two count. And Steen looks at the official. A very reasonable count by Mike Hughes. He's calling it right down the middle, folks. But Lincoln Steen has never seen a referee that he didn't like to chastise, let alone Mike Hughes, who he has a storied history with, obviously. Front face lock here as Steen wearing down Mayette. Yes, certainly the control and the advantage currently in the hands of Lincoln Steen. Wanted to acknowledge some fans here and Reggie Talbot ball hockey tournament shirts. Wanted to thank Sheldon giving a donation of tickets to that tournament. And I see they're enjoying this contest, but they'll be enjoying it more if Andre Mayette can come to his feet, which he does temporarily, but a knee to the stomach. And that brings Mayette down, as asking for the approval of the fans in New Water for receiving none. Pinfall attempt here. A two count, and again, an arrogant cover by Lincoln Steen, not hooking the legs. And you're going to need a better pinfall attempt than that to beat a wrestler the caliber of Andre Mayette. Front face lock. Trying to wear down Andre Mayette. Mayette will have to rely maybe on the energy of these fans to get himself back into this contest. For all we talk about with Lincoln Steen, he is a capable in-ring wrestler. There's no doubt about that. And he's certainly notched a fair amount of victories in ECPW over the years. I mentioned both a former heavyweight champion, former Celtic Roots champion, over 50 matches in ECPW. But Andre Mayette doesn't want to make his anniversary match a loss. They said he's on a winning streak. He wants to keep that going here. Brings himself up to an upright position, able to break the hold with some elbow drops or elbow smashes to the stomach, but a heavy clothesline by Lincoln Steen will send Andre Mayette back to the ground, back to the canvas. As Steen brings Mayette to an upright position, pinfall attempt. One and a two and a kick out. And again, Steen not hooking the leg. Arrogant cover from the veteran wrestler. As Mayette has Lincoln Steen in his sights. But he's still trying to get his bearings because he's been dominated the last few minutes in this matchup. Lincoln Steen's been able to wear him down. Whipped into the ropes, reversal. Steen feeling the impact of that. Duck over. Mayette able to keep his feet outside the ring, using the weight of his body, and now sunset flip, pin attempt perhaps, trying to bring Steen down. Steen's fighting, and he's fighting. Trying to grab the ropes, and he succeeds in grabbing the middle ropes. He has to break, and Mike Hughes is going to force him to break. Pinfall attempt. One, two. Oh, and a kick out by Lincoln Steen, who's none too impressed, but he only has 5 seconds to hold on to those ropes. Pinfall attempt, and another kick out by Lincoln Steen. Maybe getting closer here. Couple of big elbows to the upper body of Lincoln Steen. Throws him to the mat. Andre Mayette going up to the top rope, perhaps. Maybe the middle rope. High risk maneuver. No, he's going to keep it on the ground. No, now he goes to the middle rope. Splash. High impact maneuver. One, two. And another kick out. Andre Mayette throwing everything in his arsenal here at Lincoln Steen. You may not like him, but Lincoln Steen certainly showing his character on this anniversary show. He does not want to go down a loser. Andre Mayette brings up Lincoln Steen. Rake to the eyes by Steen. And a back suplex. Will that be enough? Pinfall attempt. And it's a two count. Steen looked like he hooked the leg, so he's getting serious here. And he's once again arguing the count. He's not going to win that argument, nor should he. Takes Mayette down to the mat again. Pinfall attempt. That's another two count. Leg sweep, not enough to get the victory. These competitors past the 10-minute mark here. Lengthy encounter for these two veterans of ECPW on this 20th anniversary show. As Lincoln Steen almost stalking outside the ring. Oh, wait a second. He's got a steel chair. Surely he knows he's going to get disqualified if he uses this. And Mike Hughes, he's going to have none of it. He's trying to wrestle that chair away from him. Now Mayette catches on. Oh, no! Mike Hughes ends up hitting Andre Mayette with the chair in his attempt to wrestle it away. And Lincoln Steen is grinning like the cat that caught the canary. And now he's got the pinfall attempt. And Mike Hughes, he doesn't want to count the pin. And it's one, two. No, he doesn't want to give the victory to Lincoln Steen like that. And this is just karma for Lincoln Steen. He brought the chair into the ring. There was no need for that. So judgment call by Mike Hughes, and I think he's doing the right thing here. And Lincoln Steen striking an official. And Mike Hughes, he's still got it. Listen to this crowd. Brings Lincoln Steen down to the mat. And for one more time, the fans getting to see Mike Hughes fire up at his opponent. Kick to the stomach by Lincoln Steen. And a powerful clothesline by Mike Hughes. What a treat this is, Mike Hughes. A DDT! And Lincoln Steen doesn't know what year he's in. And this all started because Lincoln Steen brought the chair into the ring, which he had no business doing. Mike Hughes, he's giving the people the officiating they want to see in this match, I think. And now he's administering the count to both men. Remember, Mayette was the victim of a chair to the head. So he's still trying to get his wits about him here. 10 count being administered. Will either man be able to answer the 10 count here? Count comes to 8. Both men somehow finding their way to their feet. What a tremendous matchup this has been. Shades of Dusty Rhodes from Andre Mayette. Winding Lincoln Steen into the ropes. Reversal along the ropes, duck. And now Lincoln Steen finding himself in trouble here, and he's taken to the mat. Pinfall attempt by Andre Mayette, a one, a two. Oh, and a kick out. What a tremendous matchup this is. Neither wrestler giving an inch. Mayette lining up Lincoln Steen in the corner. Steen ducks. Takes him down with a suplex. And Lincoln Steen establishing control again in this contest. Fireman's carry takeover here, perhaps. No, it's blocked by Mayette. Mayette. Swing Steen down to the mat. Could that be all? And it is! Old school Andre Mayette continues his winning ways here at ECPW with a massive victory at the 20th anniversary show on East Coast Pro Wrestling here at the New Waterford, a district community center. Old school Andre Mayette gets his hand raised. Much to the approval of the fans, they got to see a tremendous matchup, and they got to see Cowboy Mike Hughes mixing it up, laying down the law in this match. And now he's gonna raise the hand of the winner. Old school Andre Mayette. And he's gonna raise the hand of Mike Hughes, getting a well-deserved applause here for everything he's done for East Coast Pro Wrestling. And a great moment. Listen to these fans chant for the Cowboy. And for one more time, Cowboy Mike Hughes is gonna salute the fans. So I mentioned, didn't have the opportunity to say a proper goodbye with everything that happened during the pandemic. So great to see Mike have an opportunity to salute the fans here in New Waterford. That is going to do it for this week's episode of East Coast Pro Wrestling here on Seaside Communications, powered to you by Rogers. We'll be back next time with more great ECPW action.